Friends, can you please join me to welcome Mrs. Solheim to the podium?
It's very, very dangerous with such an introduction because you may believe that I have something interesting to say after the introduction, and of course you can only be disappointed. So that's very, very bad. No, jokes aside, I am so happy to be able to come here to one of the most beautiful expressions of human dignity, fate, human feelings, and architecture, which is this temple of the Baha'i. But again, I'm very happy to be here at this temple, which is one of the most beautiful expressions of faith and religious feeling anywhere on the planet. It's not the only. They are also very beautiful here in India, when the Sikh temple in Amritsar, since I see a Sikh in the audience here, is another one. But it shows how far humans can come when they want to express the inner feelings of religious faith and long for God in one form or the other. I know the son of the architect who made this fantastic building, his father, he wanted to make this an expression of also the Baha'i faith, but he also wanted this to be an expression of the closeness to the people or peoples of India. So he went around India looking for what were the real expressions of faith in India. Why do people in India believe that the Taj Mahal is such a fantastic, beautiful building, and of course everyone else in the world admire that building. And he wanted to express the unity of India above all divides, about religious divide, regions, caste, language, all those issues which may divide India. And in that way, in my view, he expressed the miracle which is India. Because India is a miracle. It's a miracle which is not as often admired abroad as it should. But there is any potential for division and violence in India. Any potential. Think of the fact that here you have, yes, the Baha'i religion being a small religion in the Indian context, you have the giant religion being another small religion in the Indian context, you have the Parsi religion being a small religion in the Indian context. Add to that Sikhism, there are more Sikhs in the world than there are Jews in the world. Add to that Christianity, there are more Christians. There are more Christians in India than there are Christians in all the Nordic societies of Europe combined. Add to that more Muslims than in any other nation except Indonesia. And on top of it, over to about 900 million Hindus. That is a hotspot of potential conflict, divide, and problems as a potential alliance. In similar circumstances, nearly every. Can I speak it out?
Yes.
If there are problems in the back listening to me, you just throw some tomatoes or something. I'll speak up. I'm trying to try.
I'll
turn
it off.
Coming to the point that India is a miracle in the fact that there is an Indian entity wherever I meet an Indian. He may say, I'm a Tamil. But he will also say, I'm an Indian. You may say, I'm a Baha'i, a Christian, a Hindu, a Sikh, whatever, but he will also add, I'm also an Indian. So the way of keeping this continent together, this enormous state with a population bigger than Africa, with a potential for conflict much bigger than Europe, Africa, and other places, keeping it together with one identity and making all the different religions respect each other, coming together, is a miracle, and please keep at this miracle because the soul is inspiring to the rest of the world. I know it's not enough conflicts and problems that always comes with human beings, but overall, in the 70 years or so of Indian independence, it has been remarkably held, unbelievably, and that's thanks to you, people of different communities. Scientists basically believe that we humans have always had religion and faith,
as soon as humans move from the small group of people like a gang of apes in the forest somewhere into any sort of organized community, the Legion was there. And more, you may put it all around, it was the Legion of Faith which made it possible for humans to come together. Because unless you have some overarching faith, some overarching myth, some overarching narrative, humans have huge difficulties coming together. And the humans are able to organize communities in a way no other creature on the earth is able to do. And religion from the very beginning, everywhere, has been at the center of that. We know, in my opinion, no society of any size at any point in human history without religion and faith. And the biggest proof of this was that when some politicians in some nations tried to eradicate religion from above, like communists and Nazis did in Europe in the 20th century, they replaced religion with religion-like structures. I mean, all the typical expressions of religion are there in the communist or Nazi ideology, the way they speak, the way they have preacher-like ceremonies, the way they have houses of worship, the way they have mixed, every way they made copies of religion to eradicate religion, and they made human religions which were much, much, much worse than any religion we know of in the traditional form given from. So the role of religion is absolutely clear. Francis Fukuyama, the great American historian and politician of Japanese origin, you may be aware of him, he has written about how states are formed. And these two volumes of more than 1,000 pages, basically there are two conclusions. States are formed as a result of wars and the result of religion. Those are the two pillars of state formation. Thousands of years back in, say, to China, when you go to the modern state formations of Africa, still these are absolutely critical for state formation. He distinguished, I'll be very short, he distinguished between four different relationships between politics and religion in the world. The European, which has basically been that the church and the state, and the Christian church dominating in Europe and the state, has been constantly competing for power. Throughout history, there are two sources of authority, church and state, and no one really won that competition until very, very recently. The Pope and the political leaders were fighting in every way about the political technology. Moving on to the Middle East, with Islam as the dominant religion, state and religion and faith was completely integrated. There was no way really of separating religion from state. The same leaders were the leaders of state and the leaders of religion, so we moved into one entity. Then moving on to China, where the hierarchy was exactly the opposite. In China, there has never been any doubt. Always, 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 the emperor was above religion. No religious leader could ever claim to be our emperor. State was the supreme, and religion was a method for the state to express its power, not the opposite way around. And then moving on to India, and this is the big picture thing. There, society always was superior. Society was above state. In China, exactly the opposite. And in India, you got support and in other ways through caste. Caste is, of course, there are lots of negatives about caste, but it was also a security mechanism for people, where the state was under the society. Society was supreme, state was not so important in Indian tradition. And if we allow just the comparison between China and India, leave Europe and the Middle East aside, you see on one hand, in China, state is dominant. In India, society is dominant. In China, the emperor is the supreme authority. In India, religious saints or religious leader is the supreme authority. And in China, the emperor has the mandate of heaven, as we would say, but that's a general mandate given from God at one point. And as long as the emperor lives up to that mandate, he is always, always supreme. The question asked has also been different. The ultimate question in Chinese history was always, how do we organize state in such a way that serves the human being in such a way that you keep China peaceful, effective, provide for the economy of the people. That state is the center. And the right organizing of the state is the central issue, for instance, for Confucius or Confucius. While the course in India was much, much more about the afterlife, where did we come from, where did we go after we die, that has never been central to the Chinese, what happened to us after we die. The central question is about here and now, how do we live together in the great state of China. So there are huge differences in the role religion is playing and how it's displayed. This is, of course, speaking at a very, very high level of abstraction, there's any number of nuances to this picture, but it's still, I think, very important. It is also very interesting that why the religion is so enormously important to humankind, it's everywhere. Still, at the end of the day, and you are one of the very, very few exceptions, nearly all religions on the planet come from two pairs of places. Either the Abrahamic religions coming from the Middle East, from what is today Israel, Palestine, and the surroundings, there is the Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And the other is the northern Indian plains, where you have Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, a huge number of religions. And Iran is basically the only exception to this rule, being the home, or at least the starting point, of the Baha'i faith as well as the Parsi faith. That is a kind of enormous paradox that you have religion everywhere, that you have no major religion coming from the American continent, none from Europe, none from China. So it's basically these two hotspots, Northern Indian Plains and Middle East, which has made all the religions which serve as the fourth is the anti-Judaism, Islam, all the other two brothers. Third, there is any number of local beliefs there. So, to cut it short, there's a very, very, very strong case to be made that whatever you want to achieve in society, there is peace, there is development, or its environment, we need to work with religious groups and faith-based organizations and with faith leaders and explore the enormous potential for faith for people to make good acts. If we don't do that, we are failing. What is surprising is not this view, because to me this is basically obvious. What is surprising is how limited the United Nations historically has treated religion. Basically, seeing it as a non-issue, basically being very, very cautious in doing something in the religious space. Why? Well, I think one reason is supposed to avoid conflicts, because while the religion is unifying people, it's also dividing people. So that may be one reason. But I also believe it comes from the fact that the United Nations was formed in 1945. At the time, there were two totally dominated powers in the world, United States of America and the Soviet Union. And both of them basically came with a non-religious message. The United States of America was much less religious in those days than the United States of America is today. Religion was in the backwards of society, not displayed at the frontal scene. And many Americans, and particularly many elite Americans, basically deep down believe that science will replace religion. And when we get more and more and more knowledge about the outer states, about the inner working of our body, about the nuclear processes, about the DNA, whatever it may be, science will take over, and the faith and religion will move on to the historical museum. Few would express it that way, but that would be the inner thinking of many Americans. While at the cost of the Soviet Union, it was an active decision of the Communist Party to try to destroy religion and replace religion, replace, for instance, the Church of the Soviet or Russia with communist ideology. True, when they were desperate, during the midst of the Second World War, then they brought their kids back because they understood that religion was a better motivated factor for fighting than communism. So at that point it was taken back. But that was after 20 years of trying to destroy religion, and then they didn't need religion, they didn't need the church again. After the Second World War, it was again suppressed. So we have a situation where two main powers of the day fighting for global hegemony for decades are both, so to say, besides or above religion, at least that would be their own. The awakening moment of this may not be pleasant to all of you. I think the awakening moment was Khomeini's way to power in Iran around 1980, which showed the enormous potential for religion to mobilize the masses in Iran against the Shah, but it was by extension basically everywhere in the world. And this period we are living now, only in my view, only ignorance can speak as if religion is limited or affected in world politics or in human life, which is absolutely central. There are differences. And a poll in Sweden and a poll in Burundi showed it very well. It was exactly the same question in both nations. It was very general. Was, is God playing a major role in your life? And 16% of the Swedes said yes. 98% of the Burundians said yes. So you see there are differences. But still, more people are like the Burundians than the Swedes on the planet. God is indeed in his peace or her. Sikh is one of the religions where they great if God can be a her, not just a he. Is the anti-God is he, until some feminists come and say that maybe it's not. But still, there's very few ways of expressing this the anti without God as a he and the same positive is not. But modern religion may be different, but Sikhism has been this merger from the very, very beginning. But leave that aside, religion is absolutely essential. So I would want to work as the head of the United Nations Environment very closely with faith-based organization. The United Nations has done a lot of so-called interfaith dialogue. That is good. We need more of that. But we also need to be able to work separately with every religion on the planet, on greening the work of that religion, on tapping into the inspiration from that faith, simply to work for the progress of environment with religious leaders and faith-based organizations. What would that mean in reality? Well, starting with the individual, I believe that there is no more deep-rooted expression of environmental concerns than those coming from many religions. I'm not aware of any religion where nature is completely on the sidelines, not at the center. I'm a Christian, or at least lived in a Christian society all my life. The Bible starts, because the Bible starts, or the Judaic Bible starts with the nature. God is creating nature, and he is very, very proud of himself. If you think you've done very good, see Eden, so beautiful, so nice, all the animals, all the greenery, and then at the end of that, they're topping the whole Adam and Eve as the first human being. God is very, very happy and proud of us. And the Bible ends, by the way, also with nature. John, the apostle, sitting at the Greek island, looking out of his window or out of his house, seeing a ship in a big vision, a huge flooding, which is nature brought to them at the end part of the Bible. This is the Bible. Jainism, right here in India, is of course the religion where the monks are so adamant not to destroy nature, but they can't even breathe, because then they can get insects into the mouth and then eat another creation. And you can go on, there's some of the expressions of faith from the Baha'i community, coming here. Environment concerns is at the center of many of these. You have made one of the most responsible contributions to the climate change negotiations because you want to aspire community to protect nature. But it's in Islam, in Hinduism, everywhere, and to tap into that faith, we should do a lot. Of course, also this applies to the wider way we behave. no religion can accept that we waste all the resources we have. We have not plentiful resources. In the Old Testament, in the Bible, the prophets are absolutely angry. They are coming down on the humankind very, very heavily. Why is that? Because rich people are wasting their resources. The simple fact that completely unacceptable. The prophets are opposed to the divide between rich and poor, and are particularly concerned with the rich people wasting the resources of people and become clamped down very, very hard. A similar sentiment you find in most religions. So I'm very happy to hear that you are doing your utmost to make sure that you're not wasting resources and that you're taking care of the poor. India needs to move very rapidly, frankly, on that matter. Whenever we visit an Indian city, there's an enormous waste problem. You need the inspiration of individuals for this to be taken care of, but of course you also need political leaders to act in setting up better systems for waste management, plastic industry to reduce the plastic pollution. You need acts of business leadership and the grassroots, but the grassroots inspiration is absolutely essential. Let me also add that the religious community are of course also among those with the biggest outreach of all communities in the world. Very often we speak about civil society in the United Nations, and what people actually mean is some relatively small civil society groups, very often formed in the United States of America or in Europe. There's nothing wrong with these civil society groups. I love them, we need them, we need more of them. But in most parts of the world, they are very, very minor in the outreach compared to religious groups and religious groups. Very often these NGOs are capital-based. They may be in Delhi or Colombo or in Dhaka, but the outreach in the rural parts of society is very limited. Even much more so in Africa, they very, very often are just in the capital. But the religious groups normally is in every village, all over the place, and with an outreach to rich and poor, men and women, all parts of society, which is unprecedented. So if you want to bring out an environment message, we may do it much more effectively. Not that we in the UN is formulating the message or ask you to carry it out. No. But in a constant dialogue between the United Nations and the religious community as to how we can carry the message to people about individual behavior, but also about what message we want to send to state and politicians. Because these two cannot be changed. It cannot be settled. And if I may also add, all religions are novel, this birthing of the relationship between man or woman, humans and nation. They tend to believe that God put humans into nature. They tend to believe that God did not make humans completely superior with regard to destroy any sort of nature, destroy all of the compatriots on the planet, and destroy the nature for next generation. All religions are novel. Have a message of decency, a message of responsibility that you need to convey to the next generation what you've got, or that you need to take care of the other creatures in nature. We are humans, we are the most intelligent, most effective creatures on the planet. We may be the mirror image of God, but we are there with the apes, the lions, the elephants, the grass, the insects, the spiders, even in the world. Think of the fact that the great apes, the orangutans, the gorillas, that modern science, that 99% the same as us. That only difference is 1% of the DNA, less is the same. So I'm not speaking about you, but having claim to be 98.5% the same as an orangutan. 99% the same as a chimpanzee. And if that's the case, how can we have the right to, for instance, eradicate the living space of the orangutan? Orangutans, by the way, are living just two places on planet Earth, in the forest of Sumatra, the forest of Borneo, both Indonesian islands. If the living space shrinks, orangutan will go extinct. So we must keep that living space. And I could of course speak about polar bears back home, about the panda bears in the forest of Sichuan in China, or whatever the endangered species, which is the threat of extinction, and we need to protect them. And I believe that we have to be very, very strong spiritual place. Coming to the conclusion, let me bring up the two main, the two problems, or the two most difficult areas. One is very obvious. Why? We may have embraced religion to create unity among us, because religion is also a way of dividing people. And in any religion, we have the Osama bin Laden types. I'm not aware of any major religion which should unify people. You basically claim that my faith is completely superior to any other faith. My way of living, believing, is the only right way to believe. And I may even have the right to wipe out all other human beings who do not have this. That was Hitler's view as a secular extremist. That is basically Osama bin Laden's view as an extremist Muslim. And the same is there. I mean, Sri Lanka was doing the peace process there. I can act for people, for instance, being based on Buddhism, which you when you hear the lessons of the lectures of Buddha, you will think this is the most peaceful lecture in human history, and always Buddha preached peace. But still, you find in Myanmar and Sri Lanka, the disputes are right. Minor, Osama bin Laden types. Looking for confrontation, that ever is possible to find confrontation. And what's the answer to this? I believe the only answer to this is to build on the best religions and be on the best in every religion to defeat the worst. Because religion, faith is so human, so interlinked with our deepest feelings, our feelings for our family, our neighbors, other communities, that we need to build on the best to defeat the worst. And there is any number of biblical examples. Here's one. Central African Republic has had huge problems recently. We found so many cases of Muslim and Christian leaders coming together, Muslim leaders, Christian leaders opening their churches to defend Muslims who are afraid. Why are they afraid? Because some militias who claim that they're Christians want to kill these Muslims. The Christian priests and leaders open their churches and give them protection. That's the beauty of religion, because these extremist gangs who kill Muslims in the name of Jesus Christ is the worst part of religion. But I see no other way of handling that than building upon the best in every religion to defeat the worst in the religion. The other is the issue of religion versus science. The United Nations environment is, of course, a science-based colonization. Believing that whenever there is an environment problem, the best answer is first to figure out, based on modern science, what is the best answer. And then moving ahead to how we can devise political solutions, but we need to start with science. And all modern religions I'm aware of has been able to embrace science, refer to science as a part of their message, and see that, for instance, the expression in your religion of how the world was formed as not necessarily contradictory to the research saying that the world was formed 30 billion years ago in a big bang in the universe. And seeing the way God relates to nature, not being compromised by what we now know about the DNA, or for instance, the DNA relationship between humans and the apes. So religion has shown itself to be able to adapt, take on board new ideas, and again, it's about using the best of religions to defeat the world. To embrace astronomy, but maybe not astrology. To embrace chemistry, but maybe not alchemy, which is to believe that we can evolve out of something. And to embrace the relationship between faith and science, but to defeat the obscurant ideas, which are that we can pick any idea, whether it's true or not, or whether it's in relationship to modern science. So I'm absolutely confident that faith will be in any topic we can think of a very, very significant central part of the life of most human beings. And if that's the case, why don't we work with faith-based organizations as to how we can apply their forces, their strength, their inner conviction, their relationship between God and humans for the good which we want to work for, which is to save this planet. It needs to be saved, and it cannot be saved by anyone else, but as